everyone. My name is JP Zegrand. I'm at the LSE, and with John, I'm running the Systemic Risk Center. I won the coin toss, so it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Obstfeld today. Since September 2015, he has been the economic advisor and director of research at the International Monetary Fund on leave from Berkeley. Prior to that, he was a member of President Obama's Council of Economic Advisers. His achievements are too many to list. I hope, however, that his CV grows by one notch today when he can put this keynote address onto his CV. His CV, of course, is most impressive. We all know about his academic publications. I counted the pages of his CV. And just the academic publications are 22 pages in tiny font, single-spaced. And he has influenced the way we think about international economics and international macroeconomics anyway. He also showed the power of textbooks. I guess many of us grew up on various textbooks of his, I'm sure, and I know that many in this audience have grown up with the Foundations of International Macroeconomics he wrote with Ken Rogoff. I also know that some people in the room, and I count myself amongst these, have grown up on first or early editions on his previous book, International Economics, Theory and Policy, written with Krugman and Melitz in later editions. And it's in that book that I discovered, and I think many of us discovered, the beauty and the complex beauty of some of the classical international trade theorems. And we also discovered exchange rate dynamics, all of these funky things that come out of his own research and the research of his advisor, the late Rudiger Dornbusch. I am excited, I'm sure all are excited, to find out how his thinking about exchange rate dynamics, international macroeconomics, has evolved and will evolve going forward in today's lecture, the title of which sounds exciting, is called Trilemmas and Trade-offs, Living with Financial Globalization. Professor Obstfeld.
Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre. It's a real pleasure to be here in Iceland and at this conference, which has been so stimulating. And I want to thank the organizers for putting it together, for inviting me, and the participants as well. It's been really, really great. And I look forward to tonight's celebrations. This talk is inspired by some recent views about monetary policy in small open economies. If you look at the literature, there are a number of strands, but there are two polar strands which I think are worth mentioning. One of these really dates from before the financial crisis and has been very much overtaken by events, but I think it's worth talking about just because it illustrates one of the poles. And this is the idea that in an open economy, nothing is really different qualitatively from the closed economy, provided the exchange rate is flexible. You just use monetary policy in pretty much the same way to control the price level. So inflation is under your control. Of course, this also predates the spread of the zero lower bound across the industrial world. The other more recent view, which postdates the financial crisis, is associated probably most prominently with Ellen Ray's Trilemma versus Dilemma paper. And this is one that we've been talking about intensively the last days, which is about the financial cycle and its interactions with monetary policy. And the view here is that for small open economies, such as Iceland, to take a random example, exchange rate flexibility doesn't help you that much because you're the hostage of a global financial cycle and capital flows over your borders, notwithstanding the exchange rate regime, and somehow policy has to cope with that. On this view, the large economies, particularly the United States, dominate international monetary and financial conditions, and there's not much that small open economies can do in the face of those forces. If you're thinking about both these views, it's very helpful, I think, to just state the classic monetary trilemma, which you're all familiar with. It's the impossibility of having more than two out of the three items on this list: fixed exchange rate, free cross-border movement of finance, and monetary autonomy. Under the Bretton Woods system of fixed exchange rates, where countries essentially pegged to the US dollar, and the US therefore did not have to intervene in currency markets to keep the N minus one other exchange rates fixed, it was really true that the US had a very unique role in the international monetary system, and that its decisions played the dominant role in affecting global monetary conditions. And this gave rise to a large literature on global inflation in the late 60s, early 70s, a lot of discussion about international monetary reform at the time. And one of the very influential schools in this debate was the school that argued that the way to reform the international monetary system was to have a system of floating exchange rates. Milton Friedman was of this view in the early 1950s, but Harry Johnson wrote a very eloquent polemic in 1969 called The Case for Floating Exchange Rates, 1969, in which he made the case that having floating exchange rates would insulate economies from US decisions. They would be free to pick their own inflation rates and carry out monetary policy in a way that would satisfy the mandates of their electorates. They would be insulated from whatever bad decisions the US might happen to make with respect to its own monetary policy. And this is really an extreme form of the first view, which I mentioned to you, that monetary policy in the closed economy and the open economy are the same. Johnson was basically saying, adopt floating exchange rates, you'll be like a closed economy, pick your own inflation rate. And this idea has been supported in later work in new Keynesian models, which argue that if you have one target, which is the price level, and one instrument, which is monetary policy, then you're fine. The problem with this view is that typically monetary policy has multiple objectives, and very soon after Johnson wrote his paper, Charles Kindleberger wrote a piece for the Boston Fed's Cape Cod conference, which was called The Case for Fixed Exchange Rates, 1969, published in 1970, and he had the memorable line, along with one more instrument, the exchange rate, there is one more target, the exchange rate. And this was before even there was any discussion of financial stability in the picture. So given current realities, what can we say about monetary autonomy? How much is there? And do we go all the way to the dilemma pole of the spectrum in thinking about this debate? Now, the financial cycle is real, I believe. We've seen a number of papers at this conference, even, that have been documenting it. And one of them was, we actually started off with Stijn Claessens' paper in his opening keynote, and somewhat embarrassingly, the right-hand slide here is identical to one that he showed. We did not coordinate on this, by the way, so there was complete Nash equilibrium here. What it shows is the global factors driving components of capital flows to emerging markets, portfolio flows for debt, portfolio flows of equity, FDI, and the other category, which is largely banking. And you can see the high correlation, except in the case of FDI, which is incredibly stable. On the left, there is some data at a quarterly frequency also, but which shows in more detail the components up to more recent quarters. And again, the yellow bars, these FDI flows, are incredibly stable, but there's more action in the portfolio equity and portfolio debt, and even more in the other investments. You know, what we see recently is huge gross banking outflows from emerging markets, and a lot of this is actually China. It is Chinese corporates repaying dollar liabilities to banks abroad. You know, whether we view this as part of a financial cycle or part of China's idiosyncratic conditions is something we can debate. But that's secondary to the main point that, you know, capital flows do seem to cycle. They're big and they're important for emerging markets. So how much autonomy is there? I think in discussing this, it's important to have a view of how we think monetary policy works. What should monetary policy do? And it's clear that for most of us, it's about more than simply targeting inflation. Even under a inflation targeting regime, we talk about flexible inflation targeting. So while working on this topic, I found a very nice quote from Stanley Fisher, which the great thing about this screen is, like, all of the tables that were too small in the other room, like, you can see everything. So I don't have to read this to you. It's really a marvelous quotation. But the basic point is that, you know, it's a mistake to think about monetary policy in terms of instruments and targets. Almost always, he argues, we will have more targets than instruments. And in that case, what do you do? Well, you pick the best value of your instrument, one that equalizes the marginal costs of missing your various targets, because you're going to miss all of your targets if you don't have instruments. The question is how much are you going to miss it by? And you want to miss it by the loss minimizing amount. So as he says here, in that case, we have to find marginal conditions for a maximum and to talk about trade-offs and explaining the optimum, which is where the trade-offs come in the title of this talk. So I think this is a very useful way. It's elementary, it's basic undergraduate micro, but I think it is the way we want to think about what we're trying to do with policy and how factors like the global financial cycle will affect our monetary policy choices. What happens in the open economy? How does economic openness affect the policy problem? Well, first it has to be said that economic openness offers gains from trade. That's why we don't go the route of simply erecting prohibitive tariff barriers and prohibitive limitations on international financial transactions. There are gains from trade. But in some respects, openness can also worsen our policy trade-offs. Even when we do optimal policy, therefore, we may be far away from the bliss point. But what I want to argue is that this doesn't say that the fixed exchange rate corner solution is the right one, or that we don't gain significantly from floating exchange rates, or at least much more flexible exchange rates. One respect in which I think we do gain is in the role of exchange rates as buffers. And, you know, I'm going to refer a couple of times to what Luis Catau referred to this morning, which is chapter 2 of the World Economic Outlook. I would be derelict in my duty not to refer to it and plug it. But one of the important points of that chapter is that, unlike in previous capital flow cycles, which have been well dominated, we haven't seen the types of crises that we saw in the past, at least not so far. And one of the reasons for this is that many countries have adopted greater exchange rate flexibility. So what I show in this set of pictures is on the left-hand side a group of countries with floating rates. A lot of discussion about who you classify as floating and who you classify as fixed. But these are sort of 29 big emerging market economies. And for those that are floating, what the left-hand graph does, and also the right-hand graph, is to plot the output growth forecast error between the April and the October world economic outlooks for the year shown, 2011 to 2015, against the change in the nominal effective exchange rate over that same period. And what you see is that for countries that are floaters, there's a very strong relationship that basically when countries' output is stronger than projected, something which unfortunately has happened all too infrequently lately, the currency appreciates. When output is below expectation, the currency depreciates. Now, one read of this, which I think is the wrong read, would be to say, well, this proves that, you know, currency depreciation causes output collapse. I don't think that's the right reading. I think the right reading is that when a country slows, that's in large part a demand slowdown. It creates expectations that the monetary authority will ease, or the monetary authority actually does ease in the sample period, and therefore the currency depreciates. And so the exchange rate plays this critical buffer role. On the right-hand side, for the balance of economies, which have, to some degree, more rigid exchange rate regimes, you don't see this relationship at all. So this buffering is gone. And I think this is one of the main reasons why, regardless of the financial cycle, it's very, very important to have a flexible exchange rate, that it really does give you room for maneuver. And part of this room that we see in this picture is reflecting monetary policy autonomy. So, you know, what do we mean by autonomy? Again, it comes back to this idea that the central bank is trying to hit several targets with probably insufficient instruments, with monetary policy being the one. And it's no surprise that we should think in this way, because even in a closed economy, there's no guarantee that there isn't a conflict between the inflation mandate and the employment goal, which even if it is not a mandate, as it is in the US, is certainly in the minds of central bankers. In general, there is not necessarily a divine coincidence which allows monetary policy to hit both of these targets. You know, moreover, and this is what Kindleberger, I think, was referring to, exchange rate movements have important side effects in the open economy. They're not simply an adjunct of price level control. Countries may have valid sectoral objectives. Some believe that there are externalities coming from exporting, and that one would want to not compress the export sector for that reason, or there may be adjustment challenges in abrupt exchange rate movements that cause resources to move between tradable and non-tradable sectors. And these can be even more exacerbated when the tradable sector has little market power abroad, when there are credit constraints that might prevent firms from financing mobility, or individuals from financing mobility. When there are dollarized liabilities, there can be balance sheet spillovers. And so if there's no divine coincidence in the closed economy, there's even less of a divine coincidence in the open economy. One way of looking at this is to say that the trade-offs in the open economy might be harsher even before we bring in the global financial cycle. And of course, there's a literature on fear of floating, a term that Carmen and Guillermo Calvo coined that is well known and well accepted and reflects how much more difficult these trade-offs can be. The traditional story about these trade-offs, about capital flows and exchange rates and financial stability, might hinge on the interest parity relationship, which I've written down here in, you know, obvious notation. You know, generally, just looking at this condition, you know, more exchange rate stability will require less interest rate independence, and this is the monetary trilemma. I put in a risk premium rho here, which is, you know, could also be very, very relevant for many countries. Now, if there is a capital inflow surge, say, and the central bank wishes to prevent the currency from appreciating too much because of any of the reasons that I've talked about, any of the fear of floating reasons, its intervention will lead to reserve gains, and if those are not or cannot be sterilized, those will affect the monetary base, they will affect credit conditions. Credit may flow through badly capitalized or otherwise distorted financial institutions. And this is basically the playbook for a large set of emerging market crises that we saw in the, you know, in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s, and in a couple of famous papers, Calvo, Leo Lederman, and Carmen documented these flows and the subsequent events. But the recent literature that the sort of dilemma versus trilemma discussion is drawing on builds on some even more recent insights about the interactions between domestic and global markets. And just to run through, you know, some of those, and I think these are valid, very valid insights. Many of them require more empirical work, but you know, cross-border lending can relax quantitative credit constraints in some ways, and in that way undermine domestic credit control by the domestic authorities. One response that some policymakers have made to these sorts of concerns about capital inflows, is to say, well, just, you know, let your exchange rate float, and then covered interest parity will make sure that the, you know, domestic cost of any foreign credits is the same as the cost that the central bank is setting through its interest rate instrument. And so what's the problem? If you go read Ben Bernanke's Mundell-Fleming lecture from the Fall's IMF Research Conference, you'll see him express this view. But this doesn't take account of, for example, the idea that some actors may choose not to hedge. They may be engaging in carry trades, which can affect stability. Covered interest parity may not hold exactly, especially across national jurisdictions. There also seems to be something we don't well understand, but it was alluded to earlier this morning in the presentation on Iceland. And it's true for many economies, and I'll show you a little bit of evidence of my own. There seems to be some direct long-term interest rate arbitrage. A lot of sensitivity of long-term rates around the world to long-term rates in the main industrial areas, primarily the US and the Eurozone. And this may reflect the fact that we have market integration, also that over a long horizon, people's expectations of how real exchange rates will evolve basically conforms to a kind of random walk model. We don't really know. Also, much commented on has been the special role of the US dollar. I'll say a little bit more about that. And the fact that domestic currency bond markets have developed quite a bit in the emerging world, while it has reduced original sin, which is a good thing, has raised fears that these markets have become more sensitive to U.S. policy, to Eurozone policy, to the decisions of fund managers, and furthermore that their investments in them could conceal off-balance sheet currency mismatches that we simply don't see in our data. So there's a whole list of transmission channels. You know, in terms of the dollar, the amazing fact is how much of banking activity in the world is intermediated in dollars. And if you just look at these three pictures, the left, far left one is meant to illustrate the extent of cross-border bank lending. The middle one indicates actually how important euro area banks have been in lending to emerging markets, although they seem to be retracting this lending, which in itself has been somewhat problematic. But if you ask about the currency of denomination, on the far right, the green data at the top, a lot of it is dollar denominated. So even euro area banks are largely lending to emerging markets in terms of dollars. This is, by the way, from another paper of which Stijn is a co-author. So we can expect the financial conditions in the U.S. to have a really big effect abroad because of the dollar's central role. And of course, there's been a lot of discussion about dethroning the dollar's central role in various ways. It's not just its role in reserves that is important, but its pervasive role in international financial intermediation, which is a large part of what dictates its prevalence in central banks' reserve holdings. I mentioned that there is more government debt in domestic currency, and just to illustrate that, we have this pair of graphs. So this is a very important development. It's very much in line with the recommendation that original sin dollarization should be reduced so that countries can exploit the exchange rate more easily without worrying about balance sheet effects. But again, it does expose domestic debt markets perhaps more to what is going on in the global financial cycle. So what we've learned is that you know, exchange rates, while in the world of Harry Johnson and Milton Friedman, are very good at offsetting shocks to foreign trend inflation so that you can manage your own long-run inflation rate, they don't do a very good job of cleanly offsetting portfolio shocks, financial shocks. For example, imagine that there's a portfolio shift toward an emerging market's assets. If the central bank doesn't intervene, its currency will appreciate, but dollarization, while lower, is not gone. This could increase net worth on balance sheets, and that will have effects on the credit markets. If you look at the paper that Damiano gave yesterday, it contains elements like this of credit constraints based on net worth. So this is an effect that is transmitted by the exchange rate. It's not something that the exchange rate insulates you against. You know, even if we think that the exchange rate and the current account aren't moving, there can be two-way gross flows which very much change portfolio positions and vulnerabilities. And these are things that we might not see unless we can look in a very granular way at the data. And portfolio shifts can show up in other variables that we're not used to thinking about in our standard international macro models. For example, corporate borrowing spreads. When liquidity in the global economy is loose, there can be a general compression of these spreads. And risk-on conditions will certainly affect corporate spreads throughout the world economy. We don't really have very good general equilibrium models to understand these effects. Again, most of our general equilibrium models remain macro models, and the financial sectors remain underdeveloped. So to my mind, this is a big area for research. Okay, well, let me present two bits of evidence on the transmission mechanism. One is some work that I've done, which follows up on work that I did earlier with Michael Klein, with Jay Shambaugh and Alan Taylor. Michael Klein and Jay have a nice paper in AEJ Macro on this. But it's a very simple-minded regression of changes in country interest rates on a base country interest rate, usually the US, but not necessarily, and some auxiliary variables you might think enter a Taylor rule, you know, output, inflation, and the like. With literally no monetary policy independence, you would expect the beta here to be one. You just match the base country interest rate, and you would expect the gamma to be zero. Whatever's going on in your domestic economy doesn't matter. And what you can do is pool countries and initially take the US as the base currency. And I just want to show you what you get when you do this exercise, because I think it's very, very interesting about you know, a number of empirical regularities. Okay, well, luckily you can actually see this. In the first row, this is just the simple regression of the change in your interest rate on the change in the US rate. These are short-term rates, not policy rates, but pretty short-term treasury rates, as close as we could come. And you see that the coefficient is pretty low. You might think that's because you've matched some countries erroneously to the US, when in fact they're affected more by, say, euro area conditions. So we tried to match more effectively countries to their more natural bases, and the coefficient goes up a little bit to 0.202, but still not significant. One concern in this type of regression is that, you know, interest rates worldwide may be responding to global shocks. And if Iceland and the US raise their interest rates because of a big global shock, you wouldn't necessarily say that's a lack of independence on Iceland's part. And if you match countries to different base countries, you can actually put a time effect in the regression. And in fact, when you do that, you find that the coefficient on the base country interest rate actually goes way down. So there probably are some of these common shocks here. One you might think about is the VIX. And surprisingly, that plays somewhat a different role because the coefficient goes back up. And I think the way one wants to read the VIX here is to say that the VIX is basically negatively correlated with the base country interest rate, that when we have a rise in the VIX, there is a flight to safe assets, you know, the dollar, the German Bund, and this is going to be inducing a negative correlation between those rates and emerging market rates. And that's kind of what the data are telling you here, though not terribly significantly. In the very last line, I test for the significance of the domestic variables. And for these short-term interest rates, they're very significant. So that to me is saying that, you know, at the short end, there's some independence. Interest rates are behaving somewhat differently from US or base country rates. Now, what's really interesting is to look at the long end and just go through the same set of steps, and you get quite significant coefficients. This is column 5. When you match to the right base, they become even higher. When you use time dummies, they go down, but when you put in the VIX is significant at the 1% level, and the coefficient is 0.63. And if you try to test whether anything is important in this regression in terms of domestic variables, it's hard to reject that those things don't matter. So there's certainly something very powerful going on at the long end of the term structure in terms of coherence and possibly limiting monetary autonomy. On the other hand, at the short end, there is a lot of room for interest rates to move. Another piece of evidence, and Luis Catau alluded to this this morning, comes from the WIO chapter, and he kindly allowed me to. We had a discussion over who got to use this slide, and I won. So here it is. He would have showed it otherwise. But if you look at the red columns, it basically looks at a set of regressions in which you try to link global capital inflows to emerging markets to global factors. And it turns out that for fixed exchange rate economies, which is the left-hand red bar, there's a much tighter link with global factors than for floating exchange rate economies. So here again, there is evidence that floating exchange rates are really buying you something, that it's not really a dilemma. Again, they may not be buying you everything that Harry Johnson and Milton Friedman promised, but they are buying you quite a significant amount. So my conclusion would be that countries with floating exchange rates are better placed to exercise monetary autonomy, but that doesn't mean that all is necessarily well. And it may be that the problem is really in the financial stability realm and not having that extra instrument with which to address financial stability issues. Now, again, imagine a closed economy. One of the things we learned from the global financial crisis is that controlling inflation is not the same as financial stability, right? You need other tools. You need macroprudential tools. You need microprudential tools. We have lots of debates about the extent to which monetary policy should be shaded toward financial stability goals. I think basically those who are arguing that you want to link monetary policy to the standard macro objectives and deal with financial stability with more suited tools are probably winning that debate. But the argument I want to make for the open economy is that actually, whatever might be the problems in a closed economy, in the open economy, they're worse. And here, I think, is where the Ellen Ray argument really has some bite. Even compared to a closed economy, the trade-off posed by potential financial instability for the open economy will be worse. So even if monetary policy is doing the best job that it can, it's going to be farther away from where it wants to be when you take into account the difficulty of maintaining financial stability in an open economy. The title of this talk referred to trilemmas in the plural, and so now I want to introduce the second trilemma, which is one that Dirk Schoenmaker has put forth in an insightful set of writings. And he points to the impossibility of having all three of financial stability, open capital account, and completely national control over financial supervision and regulation. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this last point. I'll come back to this at the end. There are obviously many areas in which we are now pursuing international financial cooperation simply because of the hazards that Schoenmaker's trilemma brings out. But I think it does raise a problem for monetary policy in the open economy. Now, I want to emphasize also that this point is valid under any exchange rate regime. It's painfully obvious in the euro area, where in fact there's been a movement, an incomplete movement toward banking union to deal with these problems. But even when you're talking about countries linked by independently floating national currencies, there is still a problem. So here we have a real issue. And I think Stijn in his keynote yesterday alluded to some evidence that indeed the open economy aspect does make it harder to do macroprudential. There's another aspect of the picture which might give us pause before concluding that floating exchange rates don't help with the macroprudential stuff. And this is not something that's been a big element in the debate, but I think it's very important, and it's the issue of lender of last resort. And by this I mean the lender of last resort in domestic currency. One of the issues the financial crisis highlighted was the role of the international lender of last resort. All of that dollar intermediation that I showed you suggests that there is a need for dollar finance for non-US banks in situations of financial stress. And this has been addressed now by a network of swap lines among the big central banks. Nonetheless, there's also still the problem of being a lender of last resort in domestic currency for your domestic banking system, for that portion of it that relies on dollar funding, particularly domestic currency funding, particularly wholesale funding. And this is an area we haven't really discussed that much in the context of this debate, but it goes back very, very far to the origins of writing on the lender of last resort. So whenever there's a discussion of the lender of last resort, people talk about Badgett. And they talk about Badgett notwithstanding the openness or the closeness of the economy. And Badgett, of course, wrote in a setting where England was on the gold standard. And that immediately raises the question of what Carmen and Graciela Kaminski have called the twin crises. Now, maybe you take it for granted that Britain could not be forced off gold. But in fact, Badgett's solution to the twin crisis possibility, and this is something Charles Goodhart has written about, he's left, unfortunately, was to raise interest rates very, very high. And that way you stay on gold and you can then lend at a penalty rate but you don't need to if you've raised interest rates to this extent to domestic banks. Now that's, if we think about that, that's a problem we faced in the Asian crisis, where there was a need to keep exchange rates stable because of balance sheet effects, but then you see interest rates go up, and that also hurts the financial system. It's a real dilemma. It doesn't really work. So Badgett didn't really figure this part out very well. And if you want to find someone who did figure it out very well, you have to go back to Henry Thornton, who wrote about 70 years earlier. And Thornton completely figured out the lender of last resort. But he was writing at a time when Britain had actually gone off gold at the outset of the Napoleonic Wars and had not yet returned to gold. And he took it for granted that Britain would return to gold, but he was concerned about what he called the internal drain and the external drain. The internal drain is that your banking system is illiquid, and the external drain is that the parity of the currency is under attack. And Thornton was much less sure than Badgett that you really want to raise interest rates sharply in that situation, because he was worried about the effects on the domestic economy. And in fact, even when, as Britain debated in the early 19th century, when do we go back on the gold standard, Thornton was very cautious about this. In some respects, he was the Keynes of his day about returning to the gold standard. So this is a long, tangent, but if you think about being the lender of last resort in your own currency, it's really essential to have a floating exchange rate. Otherwise, you get into the sorts of problems that we saw in the Asian crisis. Of course, you don't want to have a lot of dollarized liabilities, but floating exchange rate works much better. This is also true if you want to be able to pay your sovereign liabilities by printing money. So this is a big area where I think, you know, floating wins. Even if you need to be a lender of last resort in foreign currency, floating may help you. So a number of emerging markets hold large stocks of reserves. They have domestic agents with some liabilities, including systemic agents where those liabilities are dollar denominated. And rather than intervening with your reserves to prop up the exchange rate indiscriminately, you can use reserves strategically to help those most sensitive actors who need finance in dollars. So if you don't have swap lines from the Fed, you have your international reserves. And it's much easier to do that if you're not trying to actually target the exchange rate. You know, look at Russia, they let the exchange rate float for this reason, hold on to their reserves. Finally, there are other issues, you know, the moral hazard issues that if people think the exchange rate won't move, it may encourage borrowing in foreign currency. So even taking account in financial stability, floating exchange rate is very important. So, if that's where we are in the world, we have a lot of financial mobility, we have a financial cycle, it's imperfectly addressed because domestic regulatory frameworks are not perfect, because international cooperation is not perfect. What should we be working on? You know, at the fund, we've been thinking a lot about a number of areas where we play a role. We've been rethinking our place in the international monetary system and the global financial safety net in terms of capital flows. And I think, to sketch where there's a need for more work, I think we would stick to the view that it's not a dilemma, that flexible exchange rates help you in many dimensions, but they can't do everything. And so sound domestic macro policies, macroprudential policies, need to be adopted. And we knew that from just the domestic debate, just from what we saw in the global financial crisis. That was obvious. But we also need more international coordination in these areas. One big one is the area of international resolution, also in international regulation. And Stijn alluded to some of these issues yesterday. There are some elements of reciprocity in the system. The Basel III countercyclical buffer rules help in this regard, but it's not really enough. It doesn't really go far enough. Some countries have tried to sort of extend the reach of their domestic regulations. The Fed, for example, has required large foreign banking organizations that operate in the U.S. to set up holding companies that can be subjected easily to Fed regulation. And you might view that as a form of ring fencing, which reduces mobility within banking networks globally, but is done in the interest of financial stability. And I believe that capital controls or capital flow measures, CFMs, as we like to call them at the fund, should not be off the table. But we do have to think seriously about the possible repercussion effects on foreign countries when one country moves to capital flow measures. And, if we can think of rules of the road, sensible rules of the road to prevent accidents. The OECD has a well-developed code of liberalization of capital movements, which it has invited non-OECD members to subscribe to, and the OECD is in the process of revising that code now to make it more broadly applicable. But it is basically a treaty, and once you sign the treaty, you're supposed to obey the treaty. The fund, in contrast, has promulgated an institutional view on capital flow measures, which is not really part of our articles. We can't require countries to adhere to it, but can be part of our advice and outlook, and try to set a norm for when capital flow measures should be used. And the basic view is that try first to use standard macro measures. Don't let these be a substitute for adjustment. Try first to do macroprudential, but there will be situations in which those, for one reason or another, can't be effective, and then you may want to think about CFMs. We're in the process of thinking more on CFMs in the light of the experience we've had. In terms of the lender of last resort issue, of course, the fund is quite central to that. Swap lines are one line of attack. It's been institutionalized among big central banks. It's very unclear what the emerging markets are supposed to do in this setting, or even small open economies such as Iceland, which may not have access. So we have facilities like the flexible credit line. They haven't had that much take up. We're thinking very hard always about ways that we can make liquidity more available to our members. Gross reserves have been very useful, but gross reserve accumulation does have some systemic downsides that we worry about. Finally, everyone needs to be more resilient, and there are many ways of doing that. Some of number 1 through 7 here involve that, but certainly more equity finance, discouraging debt finance, or at least not encouraging debt finance, and lower dollarization are all important parts of the puzzle. But the bottom line is that the trade-offs can be hard. There are reforms that can make them easier. They're hard in the closed economy. They're even harder in the open economy. But floating exchange rates, independent monetary policy, certainly make an important contribution to solving this puzzle. So I'll stop there.
Some way from your target list, do you have some feeling, or can you give us a feeling for when we will be some way down the track of having achieved the 8 items you mentioned?
Well, I would characterize those items as processes rather than goals, which has the convenient feature that I don't have to say when we reach the goal. But I think we've made progress in a number of those dimensions. If you look at the balance sheets of the external balance sheets of emerging markets, there's a lot more equity as a share of those balance sheets. Now, in some cases, the balance sheets have grown, so there's more debt. But as a share, equity is more important. And Luis this morning showed a chart from the WIO Chapter 2 indicating this. There's been a lot of progress on dollarization. We see the fruits of this in the fact that we've seen some sizable currency depreciations for emerging markets in the current environment, right, along with the the capital flows, we've also seen very big depreciations, Colombia 70%, and we don't see these countries in obvious crisis yet. I always want to preface that with yet, because who knows what tomorrow's news will bring. But I think that's a huge success, and clearly there's more work to be done. In terms of international regulatory cooperation, it's an ongoing process. I think it's helpful to look at it in a long perspective. Go back to mid-1970s when the process got started. It wasn't even a topic of discussion, and the Basel Committee sort of grew up organically from the discussions, the informal discussions of central bankers, outside of the harsh light of politics. And it's become a recognized process that is, moved into the light, and that is, commands a lot of adherence throughout the world. It's not perfect. It doesn't cover all the macroprudential bases. It's still a work in progress. So, we do learn, we do progress. Unfortunately, there are vested interests, and they fight back. And sometimes you can only get so far until the next crisis happens. Hopefully that's not the case. But I think in all these areas, we keep working. There's progress. The progress is slow, but it's a race between that and the development of financial markets. The fact is, if you actually look at data, the growth, the crazy growth of finance in terms of growth rates that we saw up to the financial crisis has certainly slowed down. And that's probably a good sign in terms of policymakers' ability to get ahead of the process. Okay, thank you.
My name is Jyrki Kressen. I'm a deputy director in the IMF's European department, where with a team of people I'm following Iceland. It is our great pleasure to have joined the Central Bank of Iceland and the London School of Economics Systemic Risk Council in organizing this conference here over the past 2 days. Now, before the great financial crisis, we thought that with monetary policy, we could achieve stable inflation and sustained and stable output growth. And provided we had those two, we would also have a broadly stable financial system. This has turned out to be quite wrong. And today, with me are five outstanding policymakers and academics to discuss the consequences we should draw from this experience. So let me briefly introduce each of them. To my right is Karnit Flood. Karnit is the governor of the Bank of Israel. She spent a long career at the Central Bank of Israel, holds a PhD from Columbia University, but also has spent some time at the International Monetary Fund. To her right is Professor Carmen Reinhardt. Carmen Reinhardt is the Minos Zumbanakis Professor of the International Financial System at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. She is world known for her massive amount of work on economic and financial crises, on external debt and capital flows, and most of all for the book This Time is Different, which is one of the few economics books that has become a household name in the United States and many other countries. She has also a PhD from Columbia University and has also spent some time at the IMF. To her right is Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Turkey, Turalay Genk. He received his PhD from York and has taught at a number of UK universities before taking on his job as a Deputy Governor at the Central Bank of Turkey. Further down is Luis Pereira da Silva. He is the Deputy General Manager of the Bank for International Settlements and was previously a Deputy Governor at the Central Bank of Brazil in charge of international affairs, risk management, and also financial regulation. And this during 2010 to 2015, which was a very interesting time for Brazil. He earned his PhD from the University in Paris, Sorbonne, and while he has not worked at the IMF, he has worked at across the street at our big sister, the World Bank. And further down, last but not least, we have the governor of the Central Bank of Iceland, Mark Gudmundsson. He has spent time at the Bank for International Settlements for a number of years, where he has served as the deputy head of the Monetary and Economics Department and a member of the senior management, and that was during 2004 and 2009. And he's a graduate from Cambridge University and has also had a long career in the Central Bank of Iceland. So I propose that today we discuss, broadly speaking, three topics. What global finance means for local monetary policy would be one topic that we will probably spend most time on. And then two other topics, how and what monetary policymakers and others can do to get to stronger global growth. And finally, maybe we can also briefly talk about what changes should take place to the international monetary system to make it safer for all the people, for all the economic agents in the world. We will start with each of our panelists here giving a short set of introductory remarks, 5 to 10 minutes, and then we will have some questions and follow-up and also open it to you, the audience. Without further ado, Kanit, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, and let me first thank the organizers for this great conference in this wonderful setup and in this beautiful country. I'm very pleased to be here, and thank you for inviting me. I'd like to start maybe in my introductory remark, but just by telling you a little bit about the economic developments in Israel since the global financial crisis, and then talk a little bit about the policy mix that we've chosen, a little bit about dilemmas and trade-offs. So the Israeli economy, which is a small open economy, although I should be careful with the word small when I'm talking in Iceland, we have actually recovered fairly strongly after the global financial crisis that generally had a mild effect on the Israeli economy. And in the last 3 years, we've been growing at a moderate pace of about 2.5% a year, with a pronounced weakness in the tradable sector, mostly in industry, due to weak global demand, a slowdown in world trade, but also as a result of continued appreciation of our currency. And that weakness is to some extent offset by relatively strong private consumption, that is aided by expansionary monetary policy. The labor market is relatively strong. Actually, we've had a low unemployment, a record low unemployment of about 4.5%. Employment is growing and people are joining the labor market, so we have an increase in the participation rate, which now is close to 80%. And most of the new employment is created in the services sector, consistent with the increase in consumption. Wages have also been growing at close to 3%. Actually, they grew last year at around 3%. Inflation is very low. Actually, it has been negative. The last year, prices fell by almost 1%. And that's a result both of the decline in oil prices, commodity prices, but also as a result of a series of one-off administrative reductions in prices, including a decline in the VAT tax and some other administered prices. Another development is housing prices, which have been rising very rapidly. In fact, they grew by 100%. Since 2007, and the volume of new mortgages has been increasing very rapidly. So this is sort of the circumstances in which our policy, the central bank's policy, is conducted. Our policy target, as are specified in the Bank of Israel law, which was updated in 2010, specified that the main target, the primary target, is price stability. Subject to that, we're expected to support employment and growth, and also to support financial stability. So these are the objectives. And the policy instruments that are in our disposal are obviously interest rate, macroprudential measures that are, we can actually use them partly because the banking supervision is within the central bank, and through the banking supervision department, we can apply some prudential measures. And we've also been intervening in the foreign exchange market. So the policy mix that we've been using is a very low interest rate. Our interest rate have been set at 0.1%. Actually, we reached that point about a year ago, and also the Monetary Policy Committee has made it clear that we will remain with the current level of interest rate for a considerable time, but we haven't gone negative. We've also been intervening in the foreign exchange market to try and sort of make sure that the overvaluation of the currency doesn't get too strong. And we applied a long series of macroprudential measures in the housing, in the mortgage market. We set a loan to value at 0.75% for first-time home buyers, 50% for investors. We limited the payment to income. We also defined the share within each mortgage that can be at a variable rate. So this combination of policies is actually trying to sort of define these trade-offs that Maurice Obstfeld was talking about in achieving the various objectives at a minimal cost and trying to find the optimal mix. The foreign exchange was, as I said, intended to enhance, actually, the idea of these three types of policies was to try and enhance some of the transmission mechanisms. For example, try to enhance the exchange rate mechanism by intervening in the foreign exchange market, while trying to mute other transmission mechanisms, such as the asset price mechanism, by introducing the macroprudential measures, and to reduce actually the effect of the low interest rate on the housing prices, and mostly on the risks that are in the building up in the mortgage market, partly as a result of the very low interest rate. So the idea of these extra policies was to try and enhance some of the transmission mechanisms while trying to mute other transmission mechanisms in a sort of a combination of policies so as to reach the targets that I mentioned and that are well specified in the law. So I think I'll stop here as
Thank
an
you very
introduction.
Much. Professor Reinhardt.
Well, I'd like to address one of the questions you posed on what are some of the lessons of the crisis for monetary policy. And I guess the obvious one is, well, I guess the great moderation is over. And the idea that enveloped a lot of the discussion of among the central banks, especially prevalent in the US, but not exclusively, was that before the crisis was that we had tamed the business cycle, that monetary policy was there to focus on price stability, and that in a sense the set of instruments had been streamlined considerably so that the instrument par excellence was the policy rate. We had outgrown financial crises. We had also outgrown a lot of the more rustic instruments of the past. I will talk more about that. But I guess the big lesson as well, since the Great Moderation is over, what does this mean concretely? I'd like to focus on four issues. The first is perhaps obvious, but exchange rate flexibility is very effective in getting rid of or lowering the probability of a classic currency crisis, a classic speculative attack. But exchange rate flexibility, as we have seen, does not safeguard you against a major systemic financial crisis. We have seen financial crises. We are seeing an unfolding financial crisis in a fixed exchange rate capital controlled regime, i.e. China, but we've seen systemic financial crises in the US with floating exchange rate and high degree of capital mobility in the UK, in currency union. So I think the message that I want to convey, perhaps it's an obvious one, but the choice of exchange rate policy does not, without incremental macroprudential, do anything to safeguard against a systemic financial crisis. The second issue that I'd like to raise is one that Maurice Obstfeld elaborated, and I agreed with practically everything he said, but I would actually extend it in two directions. I think without changing the message, as stated, the emphasis seemed to be that, or one of the emphasis points of emphasis seemed to be that the for small open economies, exchange rates, they can, flexible exchange rates can deliver a lot of things, but monetary policy autonomy is difficult to achieve. I perhaps would like to push that further, and I would like to highlight that even if you're not small and even if you're not that open, that may be true. If in an era when Harry Johnson and Milton Friedman were writing, they were writing largely and still a legacy of an era of capital controls and financial repression. Interest rates had ceilings, credit allocation was widespread, and under those conditions, flexible exchange rates and monetary policy, independent monetary policy, seemed to go hand in hand. I would put to you that the U.S., which is the poster for flexible exchange rates, truly flexible exchange rates, still has far less monetary policy autonomy in the old Friedman and Johnson sense today than it did before the globalization of the financial system. I would suggest that if we look at the pre-crisis era, before we had Q1 and we had Q2, we had Q0. And Q0 were China's purchases of foreign exchange reserves on a scale which actually exceeded the purchases of the Federal Reserve, which indeed kept U.S. interest rates perhaps at lower levels than, or if one also looks at a lot of the writings and commentary by Ben Bernanke, much lower levels than would have otherwise prevail. Also in work that I've done with Vincent Reinhardt, we looked at the relationship between the policy rate, the federal funds rate, and long-term, a family of long-term interest rates in the United States. And if you look at that correlation over the course of the post-war, the correlation between the policy rate and the long rates has been declining steadily. So the whole concept that financial globalization does erode, flexible exchange rates notwithstanding, does erode a good degree of policy autonomy is not a small economy, small open economy issue alone. The third message is I think the crisis highlights that central banks should not be too quick to throw away old tools. By that I mean that one can only, when one with the benefit of hindsight looks back at a lot of the credit booms that we saw prior to the 2008-2009 financial crises, a lot of the buildup in leverage. And one wonders if there could not have been other policy tools, which are now often coming under the heading of macroprudential, that beyond the almost exclusive focus on short-term interest rates that would have been useful in mitigating the extent of the credit expansion. And let's face it, post-crises, we've seen a lot of unconventional policies. And I would put to you that now we call the unconventional policy quantitative easing. Well, the initial wave of quantitative easing was directed credit. It was credit directed to the sector that needed to be fixed, which was the GSEs. So as central banking evolved in the era of globalization, things like outside the emerging markets, things like changes in reserve requirements or credit ceilings or credit allocation seem to become passé. I would argue that we should not really call anything passé. Perhaps that just reflects my old age. The last point I'd like to highlight is that I think a lesson after the crisis is that monetary policy, I think, which some may or may not agree with this statement, we do not observe what the counterfactual of this crisis would have been in the absence of large-scale easing. I think the large-scale easing that we've seen made for a softer landing than what we would have had otherwise. But I think during the course of the last 8 years, monetary policy has also shown its limitations. Namely, it's very difficult for monetary policy to also do fiscal policy. And in some sense, central banks have been in the business of doing just that. Consistent negative real interest rates are a tax on bondholders. It does have implications also on distributional implications. But I think the part that should have, in my view, accompanied monetary policy in the post-crisis world would have been a more active role for the more active role, especially in Europe, for the restructuring of private debts. So what we are seeing is because there is a private debt overhang, there's also a public debt overhang, but there's a private debt overhang, and we are dealing with highly leveraged, many highly leveraged scenarios, a prolonged period of very low and mostly negative exposed interest rates has been in place or has been engineered since the crisis. I would put to you that I think if some of the private debts had been restructured more perhaps along the lines of what Iceland did, the balance sheets of banks would have been 8 years after the crisis a lot closer to healing, and there would be less pressure on central banks to continue with a policy of negative real interest rates and now negative nominal interest rates. I'll stop there.
Thank you very much. Deputy Governor King.
Well, thank you. I'd like to thank for the organizers for this very timely and successful conference, and also for their kind invitation. So I would like to start with connecting the first two terms of the conference title, namely capital flows and systemic risk. So the theory predicts that financial integration is a welfare-improving outcome for all parties, since it allows capital to flow from capital-rich to capital-poor economies and generate some indirect benefits, such as to do with the governance of local firms. But in practice, we know that capital flows are determined mostly by a couple of interesting factors that I'm going to mention. These are mentioned I'm taking them from the IMF publications. The first is that interest rate differential rather than growth differential between the source and recipient countries. And the second term is another important term is investors' risk appetite, in other words, the risk of price, for which we don't have good models, unfortunately, in economics to understand and analyze the impact of that. And the other one is already mentioned too. The capital flow is basically determined by financial conditions in the United States financial markets, because the US dollar is the funding currency. We don't see capital flowing from surplus countries to deficit countries, so we see the US intermediating these flows. So as a result of these factors, what we have seen, sudden surges and stops in capital flows, which cause significant problems, including financial crises in emerging market economies. So above all, what we see, capital flows show a great deal of procyclicality. So what I'm going to explain this specifically using the episode that lasted between early 2010 and early 2013 to demonstrate the impact of capital inflows on systemic risk in emerging market economies. So very low interest policy rates coupled with unconventional monetary policies in advanced economies, together with marked imperfection such as underpriced risk, led to excessive capital inflows to emerging market economies to exploit the interest rate and growth differential. But the growth differentials were really driven by demand-side surpluses in emerging market economies rather than supply-side improvements in those countries, and interest rate differentials basically driven by the policy actions of the major central banks. Excessive capital inflows to EMEs in turn generated positive feedback loop by improving their financial markets conditions, increased their risk appetite, triggered rapid credit growth, and appreciated significantly EM currencies. So these developments, together with the better economic flow and stock balance of emerging market economies, supported really pull factors and hence further stimulated capital inflows. So what happens? It happened several times in the history. At some point after economic competitiveness, as a result of an excessive real appreciation of EM currencies, got impaired and or leverage ratios heightened above a certain threshold, fueled by lower interest rate and risk perception environment, the EM world faced a reversal of capital flows. So this slowdown in capital flows really reversed the cycle of appreciation by appreciating EM currencies, worsening their financial and liquidity conditions, and slowed down their credit growth. Now, after connecting these two terms, now I'm going to connect the policy responses of the term of the title to capital flows. Well, because of procyclicality and adverse effects of capital flows, we have to manage capital flows. But there is always a first best solution, which argues that policy, coordinated global regulation and globally coordinated monetary policies, which was explained clearly by Maurice Obstfeld earlier on. But in practice, we know that coordination is not straightforward to design and implement. So as a result of that, what happened, G20 has improved the international policy coordination cooperation, but not drastically changed it. So the G20 reformed the global financial system to a great extent and international monetary system to some extent. But what is essential right now, completing the non-bank sector financial reform and extending the reform to the root causes of systemic financial crisis, such as reducing current biases in favor of debt financing over equity financing, is essential. Well, indeed, what happened recently, intermediation of financial flows shifted from regulated banking sector to unregulated asset management industry and capital market as a result of the banking sector reform. This is one of the perhaps unintended consequences of that reform. Similarly, emerging market economies, EM corporates bypass their local banks and borrow directly in the foreign financial markets. So that really highlights the fact that we need to achieve the completeness in the global financial system reform and international monetary system reform. So given the difficulties of achieving first best outcome, so there is always second best outcome. The second best approach is basically actively managing capital flows. So this is the conclusion of the G20. Macroprudential and capital flow management measures can be used to manage capital flows, and accordingly IMF and other international organizations change their institutional views on these two policies. But there are significant difficulties in managing capital flows. The first difficulty is that there are policy paradoxes. Insurance policies such as accumulation of reserves is good for financial stability but attracts capital flows, and also domestic financial market development has the same effect. The second one is important, especially in the case of Turkey, the separation problems that we have in policy space. How to separate aggregate demand management policies of monetary policy from domestic liquidity management, and similarly, how to separate domestic currency liquidity management from foreign currency liquidity management. What happened afterwards in the presence of capital inflows first and an outflows later on, we would say that emerging market economies showed a great deal of resilience to capital flows. And this is the view of the IMF. So I'm not going to repeat that. What I'm going to add to that, which was the view mentioned by the IMF, is the fact that this time emerging market economies borrowed longer term rather than the short term borrowing they did in the 80s and in the 90s. I think this had an important impact on the external financing needs of emerging market economies, on top of the factors that cited in the by the IMF, such as flexible exchange rate, effective use of reserves, and a rich set of policy tools and better frameworks. So what I'm going to now complete my this intervention with two points. And the first point is about working on first best solution rather than second best approach. The first best approach, as I mentioned earlier on, global financial system reform and international monetary system reform, and together with international policy coordination and cooperation. So we should also work on this rather than working entirely on the second best approach. Another first best outcome would be equity financing as opposed to debt financing. We know that the source of systemic risk is debt financing. And we know that there are incentives provided to debt financing. So it would be ideal to remove those distortions and provide, if necessary, incentives to equities. So maybe one final point, I will have time to talk about more specifically the Turkish case. We worked along the lines of separating policy separation problem. So introduce several measures to solve this policy separation problem so that we can use monetary policy in a way we could address both aggregate demand management and domestic currency liquidity management and foreign currency liquidity management. Let me give you one clear example, interest rate corridor policy. Well, it is interesting to note that the first time interest rate corridor used in this part of the world, basically used by Norway, not to manage local currency liquidity, but to manage foreign currency liquidity. So they used interest rate corridor to achieve that. And in Turkey, we also used interest rate corridor in a flexible way to manage both domestic liquidity and foreign currency liquidity. So with that, I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Governor. Deputy Governor General De Silva, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So let me look at this issue of global monetary and financial condition forces acting upon us and our capacity to conduct independent policies, particularly monetary policy, adding from the very nice flexible framework that the lecturer, Professor Hobsfeld, proposed us earlier. an additional layer of complication instead of simplifying it. The complication, to my view, is the political economy dimension of credit cycles. Now, of course, I think we have all in mind, and there was a rich discussion in the conference, our capacity of producing general equilibrium frameworks and partial equilibrium frameworks that can replicate essentially financial boom and bust cycles. And also, I think we have a reasonable, with the flexibility that was discussed here earlier, the capacity to essentially pragmatically manage the impossible trinity in ways in which, when we add the necessary sort of flexibility in some instruments and some areas, we can conduct a relatively independent, that is, welfare-enhancing type of policy frame. Not always perfect, but let's say you can sail through, let's say, episodes of massive capital inflows and outflows, of course, with, let's say, the caveats of always preserving the fundamentals, keeping your house in order, and so on and so forth. Now, the political economy dimension is a complication because of two things. In the upswing, it creates, when you have massive capital inflows, a very different mindset among the policy makers, particularly those in charge of making some very hard political decisions about precisely the trade-offs that Professor Hobsbawm mentioned. As we know, all of us here, we've been in situations like this as technicians, there is the sort of feel-good mindset that feeds throughout, let's say, the population, the financial sector, and even if, let's say, you have the macroprudential tools, even if you do have, let's say, some idea that things are not really right because either credit is growing at double digit, because asset prices are booming, because there is, let's say, a current account deficit that is growing, there is always, let's say, this very massive voice that, as Professor Reinhard remembers us, always tells someone in the high-level position that this time is different. We know it never is, but nevertheless, it's in the atmosphere that massive capital inflows create. It can create, of course, the feeling, the temporary feeling that, yes, you should sort of relax credit standards. Yes, you can be a little bit more lenient in terms of your policy reactions. Yes, there is not necessarily a need to be as tough as, let's say, the typical Taylor rule reaction function, even an augmented Taylor rule would call for if, let's say, this time is indeed different. So the danger with, let's say, and there is a literature on, let's say, political cycles and the way in which they interact with financial cycles. I think it's a complication of the models that we discussed in this conference, but it's worth examining because I think it's a promising way in which you can explain both what happened, for instance, with the subprime, what happens in emerging markets, in advanced economy. It's the feeling that things are, let's say, completely different this time, and that can take more risk, and you can sort of be a little bit more lenient on policy, is a recipe for future crisis. But it's a pervasive issue that pertains to any type of political economy set up in advanced economies, but also, of course, in emerging markets. It's what I would call, you remember that the word macroeconomic populism was coined by Professor Dornbusch. I would call this credit populism or financial populism. Now, the second thing is that the political economy also complicates the reaction when you are recovering from a crisis, particularly if you have to resort to a combination of policy instruments that do not necessarily pertain to a single decision-making place. And Professor Reinhardt was remember us the difficulties of having a reaction function that leans excessively in terms of using monetary policy. I think precisely, for instance, with very aggressive usage of negative interest rates policies. Of course, it might be warranted by some very temporary, very depressed demand conditions in some specific zones of the global economy. But when you push this argument too far, we all know that it has also some trade-offs in terms of the undesirable unintended consequences that it might have on financial stability of insurance companies, of pension funds, and eventually on, let's say, the confidence of actors, private agents. So the political economy in both the upswing and, let's say, the recovery has to do with the way in which we manage confidence of actors. There is overconfidence and overexuberance on the upswing, and perhaps a way in which, when you try to recover, you use too much of, let's say, one instrument because you are limited by, let's say, not being capable of, for instance, using fiscal policy as it should, as a rebalancing tool in areas where your domestic conditions do not allow. You have a difficult situation in the Eurozone, which is understandable in terms of the incomplete fiscal union that we find there, but certainly it also impedes, let's say, the more balanced and sort of equilibrated response to the crisis. So my final word here is that even if we master the analytical framework with which we can explain financial ups and downs, the financial boom, the typical boom and bust cycles, even if we do have, let's say, the array of instruments with which we can play with, including, of course, fiscal, monetary, macroprudential policies, and foreign exchange interventions, and including, as I think we discussed here, some capital flow management tools, we have also to consider the way in which these instruments are distributing according to the political economy conditions of the day. In other words, we might have to sort of get back into sort of the old literature on how to combine political economy setups with, let's say, the old classical Kindleberger, Minsky, and also why not now? I think some of this literature on confidence, animal spirits, and fishing for fools that has been put forward by professors Akerlof and Schiller. So we have a view. I think we have a good grasp of things, but the implementation, if we don't pay attention to political cycles, might be not as optimal and as, let's say, transparent and as efficient as our textbook and our sort of desire might wish. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Governor Gudmundsen.
Thank you, Jörg. Now, I think that the question that we are faced with, and I am referring back to the excellent talk or speech of Maurice Obstfeld, the economic counselor of the IMF, is the following. So, okay, we can say, is it a trilemma or dilemma? I think it is probably not a dilemma. But however, the size of the triangle varies. And sometimes it gets smaller and smaller and getting much closer to being precisely a dilemma. Especially if you take the legitimate concerns that are behind fair or floating into the picture and the financial stability aspects. So the question is then, so how can we keep the triangle a triangle? How can we expand the size of the triangle? And how can we mitigate the trade-offs that Maurice Obstfeld talked about? And it is not easy. It is pretty difficult. And I can tell you, if monetary policy in the small open economy called the US is complicated, it is much more complicated in the very small open and financially integrated economy like Iceland and some others, as we used to be. What is the problem here, basically? And this is an issue that I have been thinking about long before I came into the current position and was doing work on back at the PIS, of course, with an eye on Iceland, but also with an eye on a country like New Zealand, which in some sense I thought was a better example to see the kind of the pure monetary policy problem than in the case of Iceland, where the kind of the imbalances in the financial sector and the financial stability issues got so much mixed in with things. And it was clear that in the build-up, in the years before the global financial crisis, what we observed is precisely what we saw here in the regressions that Maurice Obstfeld showed us. And that was, yes, small open economies, they can conduct an independent monetary policy in the sense that they are free to set their short-term interest rates. But the transmission mechanism of monetary policy through the yield curve was getting weaker and weaker, because the longer end of the curve was getting more and more packed to the kind of long-term interest rates. In the US, maybe a little bit in the Eurozone, at least we are now dealing the world in this conference into what we call small open economies and what we call core rate setters. And certainly New Zealand, Iceland, Israel, etc., they are not core rate setters. So in the end, we can, if we think about this theoretically, then we know that financial globalization, if we ignore the, you remember, the uncovered interest rate parity condition that was shown to us by Maurice Obstfeld, there was a risk premium there called rho, which varies, but if we ignore that for the time being, then as countries become more financially integrated and the process goes further and further and further, you could imagine a situation where the transmission of monetary policy through the interest rate channel becomes almost blocked. And that matters because we are sometimes in monetary policy, we are trying to influence saving decisions, investment decisions, and things like that. And often longer rates are more relevant. For instance, the lending rates of banks are often more linked to these longer rates than to the short rates set by central banks. But still, you could still hit your inflation target because you always have the exchange rate channel. And in the limit, it works. And it worked in the case of New Zealand and many other countries. But the problem is that exchange rates are a little bit erratic phenomena, and they, because the uncovered interest rate parity doesn't hold really, except at in the very long run. So you have these possibilities of excess volatility, exchange rate going up the stairs and down with the elevator in a disorderly manner, that then can interact very badly with financial stability, especially if there are significant financial vulnerabilities, currency mismatches, maturity mismatches in FX, policy conflicts between monetary policy and fiscal policy, which pulls your interest rates higher than the rest of the world. We had that problem here. And maybe then if you have some shocks, specific shocks hitting you and triggering the whole thing, it can't go very badly. So we in this country, we are now behind capital controls. So comprehensive capital controls and outflows. So we are not faced with this problem now to the degree that we were in the past, but we are now in the process of lifting those. And hopefully we will go far this year or early next year or whatever. And we are preparing for that. And in order to prepare for that, we are drawing the lessons. So what can we do in order to mitigate these problems? And what can, and in principle, you can think of, if you think of three ways to mitigate the monetary policy problem, you can decide that you are never going to let your interest rate differential become too large, but then you are no longer running an independent monetary policy, because what is an independent monetary policy? Yes, it is the ability to set an interest rate that is different from the rest of the world. But you could do that, and you would solve this capital flow or reduce the capital flow problem, but then that might be at the cost of destabilizing the domestic economy. You can enter a monetary union, unless stop trying to conduct an independent monetary policy. You are then no longer small in terms of monetary policy, but that creates other problems, and there are other pros and cons, and that will not get away from the capital flow problem and the financial stability problems associated with that. Or you could do what we intend to do, which is to kind of change the policy frameworks, increase the resilience of the financial sector and the corporate sector and the households, so that we can be less fearful of floating, use foreign exchange interventions to mitigate the or reduce the excess volatility and try to work against medium-term misalignments. So but that is difficult, because then you may need to make an assessment, so where is the equilibrium exchange rate, etc., etc. So we will have some kind of inflation target. We call it the inflation targeting plus, where the foreign exchange intervention is a part of it. Macroprudential, yes, that will help, because that will dampen the domestic credit cycle a bit, and therefore reduce the demand for the loans that are flowing in from abroad. And finally, we are contemplating some kind of capital flow management tools, so that we can, then we are working on the financial integration part directly, either through a tax or through a reserve requirement that is at zero interest rate or something, which would then reduce the interest rate differential, create a wedge between the interest rate that the domestic residents are facing and the interest rate that our foreign residents are facing. However, we know it will be no panacea. It will have side effects. It will take us to the limits of international obligations. So it should be maybe second or probably third line of defense, as we talked about here. And then in the end, it might not work because of the political economy issues that Lewis mentioned here. So we will have to try again and hope for the best.
Thank you very much, Governor Gudmundsen. Let's now have a series of questions for the monetary policy makers here. We heard from Maurice Obstfeld that there are two views out there. One view is you are completely independent as a small open economy. Another view is you have virtually no control over your country. So my question to you is, where do you situate your own economies? How much confidence do you derive from the new instruments that you are deploying, like macroprudential policy and exchange rate intervention, in terms of giving you more independence? To what extent are you therefore confident that you can deliver for your citizen better in the future with respect to stability of inflation, financial stability, and growth? Governor Kenny, you have had a lot of experience in that domain. You mentioned macroprudential policies that you have deployed and exchange rate intervention. So how has this been working so far?
So I think we're not completely independent. Obviously, we're, first of all, we're subjected to the global shocks, so, and to the global business cycle. So the fact that inflation is low and it leads the large economies to have very low interest rate, or the fact that growth, global growth is very slow, and as a result, world trade is slow, and as a result, there is a slow, an effect, a dampening effect on our economy, means that our policy needs to be accommodative regardless or independently of the fact that the global or large central banks also have very accommodative policy. On top of it, obviously, the accommodative policy by large central banks affects the capital flows and exchange rates. So I think all of that leads to the need to have accommodative policy in the current state. I think the extent to which our accommodation is reflected in interest rate is dependent on the other policy measures that we can employ, and the fact that we can we have been intervening in the foreign exchange means that we could economize to some extent on reducing interest rates, and we didn't actually move all the way to the negative interest rate, thinking about the potential risks, known and unknown risks in the negative zone, was possible because we could use the foreign exchange intervention to sort of limit the fluctuations or the appreciation pressure. The other factor is, I mentioned the risks in the mortgage market, and here I think the ability to actually, and the fact that we have the mandate to use macroprudential policies in the mortgage market, allowed us to go as far as we did to almost zero interest rate, in spite of the risks that are building in that sector. And I think these, actually, these policies seem to be effective, at least in terms of the reducing the risks of mortgages. They're still increasing, but when we look at the risk profile of these mortgages, they seem safer. They have lower value in terms of the lower LTVs, lower payment to income, and also the fact that we limit the share of a variable rate within each mortgage means that there is less of a risk of increased payment once interest rates will go up, and at some point they probably will. So I think that allowed us to go all the way to a very low interest rate and manage the risks in the mortgage market. Now, it does have political economy, it raises political economy questions. And I think the fact that actually a central bank has the mandate to employ these policies makes it in some way easier, because we're less concerned about the short-term political effects of limiting the mortgages and placing all these restrictions. Actually, in our case, the political system was quite happy to have the central bank do these or employ these restrictive measures, which would probably not have been employed if it would be the political system would have to actually pay the political price for introducing all these restrictions that are not terribly popular.
Deputy Governor, where do you place Turkey in this setting of independence versus being at the mercy of global capital markets? And Turkey has seen a large increase in credit over the last 5 years. And how have you dealt with this? And what was the effectiveness of the instruments in your view?
Yeah, I think if I look at the history of monetary policy in advanced economies, quite similar to monetary policies of emerging market economies. Take, for example, Germany in the 70s, used almost similar policies that we have been using. In other words, we have been using similar policies that Germany used in the 70s. What Germany did when they faced excessive capital inflows, they lowered the policy rate, and then they increased the reserve requirement ratios and introduced prudential measures. exactly what emerging market economies that in the wake of uncommercial monetary policies. And the same applies to European economies right after the Second World War, when there is a gap between equilibrium interest rate and market interest rate. They address this gap using macroprudential policies. In the U.S., history is quite similar to what we have been doing. For example, U.S. used macroprudential measures very aggressively, and not only in a very prudential way, but also to fine-tune aggregate demand and also to change the composition of bank loans. That's what we have been doing, for example, heavy reliance on macroprudential measures, reserve requirement policy, and exchange rate intervention. May not be direct intervention, but some strategic investment, as Professor Obstfeld mentioned. We identified the factors causing volatility, state-owned oil and natural gas companies have irregular activities in the exchange market. So we sold the foreign currency directly to those companies, so that lowered the volatility in the exchange market. So with these macroprudential policies and extensive use of reserve requirement policies, what we are trying to do is that not really changing the triangle, but influencing the shape of the triangle rather than completely omitting the triangle. Triangle is there, but there are margins on the triangle that you could exploit. So the extra measure that we have is really exploiting those margins. The interest rate corridor that we used, I think, was quite effective during the excessive capital inflow episode. So lowering the deposit rate aggressively and cutting the policy rate really reduced the short-term capital inflows. So that's basically the source of funding for domestic credit. So as a result, we have a slowdown in domestic credit. The reserve requirement policy has been interesting in Turkey. We used with different objectives. One objective is to incentivize banks to increase their core financing as opposed to non-core financing. And also when it comes to external financing, we used required reserves to lengthen the maturity of external liabilities. So there are various ways of influencing not only great demand, but also regulation side.
Professor Reinhardt, are we at risk of simply asking too much of monetary policymakers? I mean, we're bringing all these levers into play now: exchange rates, and the literature on the effectiveness of exchange rate intervention is decidedly mixed. Macroprudential measures, interest rates. I mean, are we just trying to set up here machinery that that moves towards central planning, so to speak, and in the process also fuzzing the mandates of central banks? Is that a risk in your view?
On capital flow management, per se, I don't think we're asking central banks to do anything now that was not in previous cycles. If you look at the menu, do you intervene or not intervene? If you intervene, do you sterilize? If you sterilize, how do you sterilize? Are capital control / macroprudential complementary? Is fiscal policy at some point outside the control of the central bank going to also contribute? But the menu is essentially on capital flow management. I don't think we're asking central banks to do. And it stands to reason that central banks can act quickly. And we know that capital can flow in quickly and flow out quickly, so there's a match there. I think I will go back to an earlier remark that I made, that one of the lessons of the post-crisis is very stimulative monetary policy for a whole host of excellent reasons has been used post-crisis to avoid a worse outcome. But at the same time, I think that if you look at historical financial crises, excepting the Japanese crisis, part and parcel of the financial crisis resolution has been the restructuring of bank debts, of private debts in a much more aggressive. And that, as private sector balance sheets become healthier, quicker, provides in and of itself a source of stimulus that isn't dependent on interest rates being as low as they have been for as long as they have been. Secondly, central banks are being, on that score, being asked to do too much, in that the absence of a balance sheet cleanup, if you will, also impacts the transmission mechanism of monetary policy. The credit channel, if you have a bank that is evergreening pre-existing debts, it's, notwithstanding low interest rate, its scope for new lending is much more limited. So I think on that score, I would say that we are asking central banks to deliver too much, but not on the macro, you know, capital flow management. I think the biggest challenge that central banks face on the capital flow management is on mitigating the pro-cyclicality that is built in so many layers in the capital flow cycle. The private capital flows tend to be pro-cyclical. Oftentimes, fiscal policy also tends to be pro-cyclical. Rating agencies tend to be pro-cyclical. So central banks have to fight a lot that pro-cyclicality.
Mr. Pereira da Silva and Mar Gudmundsen. You talked about credit populism. Okay. So, and Akerlof and Fisher have written both about aspects of such populism, or what drives such populism. So do you believe that we can address pro-cyclicality just with our policies, better fiscal policies, better financial policies, better monetary policies, or are there like other requirements or other needs with respect to, you know, educating society or protecting people, consumer protection and so on, in order to change the trade-off that central banks face?
I think you need naturally to have always prudent policies and keep a balance between the instruments that manage aggregate demand. You need to use policies that are preventive, and particularly financial regulation in many aspects are instruments that prevent the build-up of excessive financial systemic risk, and you need perseverance. These policies take time to materialize. Now, the point to come back to Professor Reiner's issue is that currently in the recovery, the usage of the public sector balance sheet has been unbalanced in terms of excessively putting too much burden on central banks and much less perhaps on other parts of the public sector balance sheets, for instance, governments. That naturally we do face issues of precisely limits to public debt, the political economy of how to engineer a more virtuous cycle of, let's say, rebalancing policy frameworks. But I'm sure we can be, let's say, taking a little bit out of the lap of central bank, particularly not embarking in, let's say, for too long experiments that we know pose risks to financial stability, but perhaps thinking of, let's say, areas where there could be investments that can bring productivity to societies that have, let's say, areas where you have some slack. Think of, let's say, youth unemployment in Europe. And by rebalancing with, of course, the constraints of the political economy that we have in many countries, not only in Europe. I think we all know the difficulties in congresses of the US, in Brazil, in many emerging markets. But the way in which both in prevention and in crisis resolution, you have to use in a balanced way all the instruments available at your disposal in order to have an outcome in terms of the response function of the authorities that bring social welfare up, and that is balanced, I think is, let's say, what we are looking for now. I'm not saying that this is easy, this is a complicated task, because it implies a lot of, let's say, coordination in terms of the political actors within the society, the ministers of finance, the congresses, the central banks, the monetary authorities, the regulatory authorities, and also internationally, in terms of, let's say, the possible coordination of such actions with, let's say, multilateral institutions, for instance, that can finance these investments in productivity-enhancing activities that can sort of get a kick and a confidence kick to a recovery, for instance, in monetary unions. I think I'm hopeful that these types of solutions can be discussed in a constructive way.
A last question before opening it up to the audience, Mar. I mean, some argue that society gets the credit booms it wants to have. So ultimately, laws will be changed or politicians will be voted into office that deliver the credit boom that society wants to have. Doesn't that call for, like, you know, another way of tackling financial instability, something that involves more broadly, you know, education of people and consumer protection and a whole other agenda, something that's been emphasized by Robert Schiller, for example?
I think the answer is yes and no, in the sense that look at what happened last time in this country. What happened last time in the build-up to the crisis was very much related to what was happening with the global financial cycle. And politicians in Iceland, they are very powerful, but they cannot influence the global financial cycle. So the ample cheap credit availability in the world mattered a lot, along with the European Union regulations on cross-border banking, which was deeply flawed. Where the banks had European freedoms with no European safety nets to back it up. So, but yes, up to a point there, there are things that you can do domestically. And I'm all for financial education and financial literacy. I think that is very important. But however, I would want to come back to this issue. So will we be able to do this? And I don't think we have the answer to that, because, and in some sense, we have no alternative. We will have to try. I don't think that monetary policy and central banks have too many instruments, and I think they actually need more instruments. And what we are doing, in some sense, with macroprudential capital flow management tools, we are taking off the shelves instruments that used to be used by central banks way back. It is like in the Star Wars movies when you find an old lightsaber and you dust it and start to use it. So, but what we need more instruments, but we don't need more goals, so to speak. We cannot overburden monetary policy, because that is very risky, and that is something. So what can we do for sure? I mean, I think we can increase the resilience of the financial sector. by having higher capital ratios. Now, whether all this more fancy stuff in Basel III will work or be pro-cyclical in its own right remains to be seen, and might very well be the case. We can also do something that we have done here in this country. We have introduced regulations. Remember, just before the crisis, the Icelandic banking system was 10 times GDP, and almost two-thirds to three-fourths of the balance sheet was denominated in foreign currencies, with a maturity mismatch and no lender or last resort to back it up. And that was an accident waiting to happen. And so it did. But we have now introduced a specific liquidity cover ratio in FX, and more importantly, a specific net stable funding ratio in FX. And if you then, in addition, would say put significant limits on foreign currency borrowing by unhedged borrowers, then that will take you afar. For instance, with the net stable funding ratio that we introduced, it would have been impossible to build the banking system that was there, because what it does, it makes the maturity transformation much more limited, and then it is not interesting to the bank. So, and finally, what we need to do is to work for more coordination between prudential policies, macro monetary policies, and fiscal policies. That is difficult, but we in this country, we are, because you need to preserve the independence of policies at the same time, but we are going to try that in this country. We are introducing a so-called macroeconomic council. The government is on it, the central bank, as the partners on the labor market. We'll see how it works.
Yes?
Just a footnote. I think the bottom line is that monetary policy cannot solve structural reforms. Yeah. Monetary policy can buy you some time, so mm-hmm. that societies can decide the way in which they are going to conduct the needed reforms that they themselves feel are necessary to be more productive, to be more competitive, to sort of have an array of, let's say, social service that is compatible with the resources that they have in their budget and in their economy. Monetary policy can sort of buy a little bit of time, and we are already buying sort of a lot of time in this debate, but the final decision has to be with private sector and public sector agents in other areas of economic policy.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, let me now open it up to the audience for questions. If you could please identify yourselves, and then we have a microphone here up front on the left, and ask your question. Yes, please. The microphone is here up on the left.
It's not working. Oh, now it is.
It
okay,
is working.
Thank you. Well, my name is Tjörvi Olason, and I'm from the Central Bank of Iceland. I want to raise a question that touches upon the things that both Reinhardt and Luis da Silva discussed about, and that is the political economy feature, and I want to relate it to debt restructuring. Because I agree with Professor Reinhardt that what has been lacking in many places after the crisis is genuine debt restructuring instead of just pushing the problem forward. And Iceland, as I showed in my presentation earlier this morning, is often used as a successful story in terms of debt restructuring. And as you could see, all debt levels have come down considerably. I would argue that it's not necessarily, this was a huge issue in terms of political economy, and a key thing was how we restructured the banks. And if you take the US example, they recapitalized the banking system early on, but did it through a footnote in the TARP legislature. So the politicians actually thought they were doing something else. So how can you solve, that's the question, how can you solve the political economy difficulties of doing genuine debt restructuring when you're years after the crisis and you're not going to get the politicians necessarily to inject bank capital, capital into the banks such that they are in a position to do genuine debt restructuring because that's going to be costly in terms of their capital position?
Professor Reinhardt.
So I would, that's an excellent question, and I'm not dodging the bullet, but debt restructuring is something that is very much a case-by-case basis. In the U.S. also, don't forget that as disorderly as it was, the foreclosure, the wave of foreclosures was actually a mechanism that wasn't restructuring, was outright default, but it was a powerful mechanism in bringing down household debt fairly quickly. Not necessarily orderly, but effectively. How can you open up that can of worms at this stage? Well, I think in the U.S. it would be very difficult. I think it will be very difficult in Europe, but I think the motivation to do it in Europe is greater. If you look at the pace of recovery, much of Europe is still, many of the countries in Europe are still below their per capita incomes in 2007. The pace of recovery has been slow and very tepid. I think the real issue that has, I mean, restructuring is always complicated. Witness what we've just seen with Argentina and in idiosyncratic ways. But I think a big complicating factor in Europe is that in the end, it is bringing a fiscal cost forward, and in places like Germany, which is a creditor country, that fiscal impact is far from trivial. And reopening that at this stage, I think, will be difficult, but I wouldn't say impossible. I'm going to use loosely this historical example. If you look at, it was all official debt, so it was a different animal. It was more like the debt of Greece or the debt of Portugal, which is not quite to the same extent official, but close. After World War I, there was a debt overhang that depressed growth for many, many years. The discussion of restructuring began as early as 1922. The actual outcome was 1934. So the point I'm making, hoping it doesn't take 12 years this time also, although we're marching in that direction, but I think it shouldn't be closed. It should be on the table. Because I do think that it's not like there's a huge list of alternatives that are presenting themselves as obvious solutions.
Thank you. Yes, over there, please.
Thank you. I thought I saved time, so I'll just... So, Tor Peterson from the local central bank. Just a general question to the panelists. So, the cornerstones of monetary policy, as we were taught, is move away from the discretionary policy to a rule-based, clearly communicated, and transparent monetary policy. So should we worry that we're adding all these tools, should we worry that we're getting back to the bad old days of not very clearly articulated monetary policy that gives blurred signals? And maybe, Turulay, you explained what you were doing in Turkey. It must have been very confusing for market agents to understand what you were doing. You were raising rates, but you were also lowering rates at the same time. So are we getting back to the bad old days where we were doing discretionary monetary policy?
Can I have two answers? One from Governor Fluke. Karnit, what do you think?
I think when you have only one target and one instrument, it's easier to communicate. But I think at least what we're trying to do is explain the trade-offs. And it is more complicated, but I think that with time and with trying really to explain the trade-off, the public does understand more or less what we're doing.
Deputy Governor.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's a trade-off. I mean, there is cost and benefits. Sometimes benefits outweigh costs, so you implement discretionary policies that you called. For example, as I explained earlier on, we have been using wide interest rate corridor to basically trade off volatilities in two different markets, interest rate and foreign currency market. I mean, in normal times, you would expect volatility in interest rate market is more important than volatility in FX market, but there are certain times it's vice versa. So we implemented this wide interest rate corridor. But there is serious communication issues. We have been having these difficulties for some time. It's difficult to, you know, communicate the true sense of monetary policy. It would be nice to have one single policy rate determines your monetary policy stance. At the same time, you communicate your monetary policy stance with that interest rate. But that wasn't the case for us. So there is a trade-off, basically, and cost-benefit analysis.
Thank you. Professor Reinert, you wanted also to...
Let me just take a slightly different twist on your question and bring back a phrase from Alan Greenspan, who from time to time used constructive ambiguity. There are certain instances where transparency, clarity, rules, and all of that are not necessarily what you want. And I think the discussion we've been having in the context of more flexible exchange rates is an illustration of that. I think one of the steps forward that has allowed many countries emerging and advanced to deal with, to cope better with collapsing oil prices and commodity prices and allowing their currencies to adjust without a full-fledged speculative attack is the fact that in the context of a managed floating exchange rates, central banks haven't been out there with very explicit, transparent, and clear exchange rate rules that are very easy to attack. So I'm making a case for muddling. I'm saying that we have to also weigh the benefits of what you're going to be transparent on.
Mr. De Silva?
I concur that communication of monetary authorities has become more complex in an environment where you do have a complex assessment of key parameters of their policy function reaction. After all, you do have debates about the way in which deleveraging is being processed, whether we are or not in a secular stagnation situation. And therefore, the capacity to sort of be capable of providing in an inflation forecasting, targeting regime, the right sort of horizon for private agents has become more complicated. Now, I think we can still, and in my past experience, try to do that. And the other element, I think, to sort of get a little bit more concrete in separating things is that many central banks have now instituted not only a monetary policy committee, which is the old traditional way of communicating the policy rate, but also a financial stability committee where some of the decisions regarding financial stability are taken. So perhaps this is a way to improve the clarity, the transparency, and also the guidance of the communication.
Thank you. There was a question in the back. Yes, please. Can you please walk up to the microphone, because this is webcast on the websites of the Central Bank of Iceland and the IMF.
Hi, Arthur Doohan, Arthur Doohan, an independent consultant. Would Professor Reinert agree that the delay in addressing the debt restructuring in from 20 to 34 set the at that stage, that 1939 was inevitable, and that some of the delay in restructuring now is giving us, fortunately, weak but worrying echoes in the polarization we're seeing in Europe? The restructuring is necessary to eliminate those political pressures.
I think, again, I don't think it's appropriate to make blanket statements about the magnitude, the sectors, the composition of debt is very different across many of the post-crisis European countries. In Italy and in Spain, most of the debt is still in private hands, and it is some public and some private. I primarily, without getting into the whole layer of controversy of sovereign debt restructuring, I'm actually talking about private debts at this stage. And I think that if one looks at the experiences of prior banking crises, including East Asia, which 8 years after the financial crisis and much before that had already been growing quite rapidly, what one does see, especially in the property market, a lot of the lending connecting to the pre-crisis real estate bubble, those debts had been sometimes quite in quite fire sale ways. I'm not saying again that it's a panacea, that it's easy to do, but I don't see how 10 years from now we can still be in the extend and pretend that we've been carrying on.
Okay. Other questions? Sorry. Yes.
Yeah. Look, these are ex post solutions for the existing debt stock, but
they're historical too. I mean, this
historical
is
too. What I'm going to say is that there may be extant solutions with convertible bonds. But unfortunately, markets do not show much interest. For example, the idea of GDP-linked bond would be one way of, you know, elevating sovereign that problem. But I mean, it's up to basically markets' interest is the key in this area.
Any more questions? If not, okay, go ahead.
I'm Ashok Bhatia from the IMF. I have the pleasure of working on Iceland. Clearly, macro-pru is very much in vogue nowadays. As some of you have noted, it's a case of the old shoe being back in fashion. My question is about the other old shoe, which is microprudential. And the question is, how much of all these good things can be accomplished simply through high-quality microprudential oversight? Which to me should look at underwriting standards, should look at loan-to-value ratios, should look at collateral values, foreign exchange mismatches, you name it. Perhaps in countries with thousands of banks, it may be different, but in small countries with three banks or four banks, would it not be enough just for microprudential supervisors to do their job well and talk to each other?
Can I maybe have the views of both Karenit and Mar on this to conclude?
In terms of the instruments, actually, it's the same instruments that you would use for microprudential or macroprudential. It's the question of what is the problem that you're tackling, at least in our case. I think when we look at each bank and we do stress tests, we are not too concerned about the issue of rising mortgage volume in their portfolio. But when we look at the sector as a whole, we're concerned about the interconnectedness and the possibility of a broader problem. So I think it's the same instruments, but from a different angle, looking from a different angle at the problem. And I'm not sure that if we would look at the micro of each of the banks, would actually apply the same measures.
Yes, I think you can accomplish a lot with that, and that has to be part of the package. I mean, we are dealing with a problem where there is not one kind of panacea solution, and that's it, and we can all relax. And everything has to come together, and everybody has to play their role, monetary policy, fiscal policy, prudential policies, both macro and micro. And in this country, for instance, so a very small country, a systemic crisis issues come down to three things, and they are FX, FX, and FX. And we have three commercial banks that are doing FX trading, and if you somehow regulate these banks correctly and supervise them correctly, that will take you far. But however, we need to give the supervisor the tools to work with. For instance, yeah, they can make comments on loan-to-value ratios, but the regulation has to come from the macroprudential discussion. So it all has to fit together.
I would like to thank you all here, and let's give them a hand. Good. Now it is my pleasure to introduce the closing speaker, John Danielson. John Danielson is at the LSE, part of the Systemic Risk Council. And as so for us, it's been a great pleasure at the IMF to work with the LSE and the Systemic Risk Council on this conference. And I've also found out that you did spend some time at the IMF, like a number of people here. John, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction. To most Icelanders, HARPA signals, or being in HARPA, means performing arts, not conferences. So when I talk to my relatives and tell them, I'm going to perform a HARPA, they often ask me, are you going to sing, or are you going to dance? And when I tell them, no, I'm going to perform economics, they always get disappointed. But sadly, this is all I can do. I can't sing and I can't dance. But when we conceived of this conference a few years ago, I was talking to Sigríður Benediktsdóttir, who is the head of the financial stability at the Central Bank of Iceland. You notice that most discussion on macro-pru focuses on the large currency areas, the United States, Europe, UK, Japan. We have very different problems from the rest of the world. And we said, why is there so little discussion of the problems of Iceland is facing, or Turkey is facing, or Cyprus, or any of these countries are facing? And so we decided to put on this conference, and we were fortunate enough to get the IMF on board to put on this quite excellent event. Now, however, I of course do have close connections to these institutions. My first job as an economist was working at the Central Bank of Iceland. And I'm sort of slightly embarrassed to mention the job I did, because at the time they were managing foreign exchange policies, and I created a model that said if you devalue by 20%, the fishing sector will profit by 10% and the construction sector by 5%. So I created this model and they liked the model, but then I went one step further and upset them. I created a menu-driven system. So anyone could log onto a system and do it transparently. So I think they liked the fact that the model existed, but it did not like the fact that you could actually do it as a menu. So I doubt they used the model at any point in time, but Mar would know better. And of course, then my next job was at the IMF, I was also an intern, but of course, at the end of the day, I'm not suitable for a proper job if I got into academia. Now, that said, my interest is macro-pru. And one thing I'm sort of missing from the conference a little bit is the political economy of macro-pru, because I think it is quite different from the political economy of monetary economics and anything else. And really, what we've been talking about in the conference, and this is something we've been talking about macro-pru from the point of view of the global financial regulator. This is the view that Stijn outlined really well. Whole bunch of tools, you tweak this, you get that, and you do that, something good happens. There's a big menu, and all the policymaker has to do is to pick the tools. We've been researching this, the political economy of macro-pru, quite a bit at LSE. And we sort of come to the conclusion that the global regulatory bureaucrats also have to face the people who believe in individualism and say, free markets work. The market is the best allocator of resources. Who are you to say that you can control the financial system and make it better? And then these people are confronted by the 99% take back Wall Street. There's no Icelandic equivalent of Wall Street, by the way. It tells you exactly how unimportant the financial sector has been. And these are the people who say the financial system is all about exploiting the poor and giving money to the rich, just close down Wall Street. And then you have the last constituency, the cynics, who say it doesn't all work, but let's all profit from it. I think one big difference between macro-pru and monetary policy is nobody questions the need for monetary policy. A lot of people have very good arguments saying macro-pru does not work and should not be implemented. And I think that criticism has not been properly answered. Now, but we are making progress. But Iceland does make quite a unique laboratory for many of these issues, because it provides a very nice link between macro and monetary. Now, this is a link I sort of missed in the conference. I hope one of these models would take up this point, because a big reason why Iceland got into the crisis, of course, is its inability to manage its currency. The year I left Iceland to go and study in the United States, inflation hit 130%. And it has always been persistently very high. The current 1.9 is quite an anomaly, if you live in this country. And the faith in the currency is very low. The problem before the crisis is, and this is a big reason why Iceland got into a crisis in the first place, is because it's every time inflation went up, the economic model said raise interest rates, because if you have an inflation targeting model and you apply a Taylor equation of sorts, inflation goes up, the automatic response is you raise interest rates. The problem is when the CPI, the Central Bank of Iceland, raised interest rates, inflation increased. The causality went the other way. And the reason, of course, is, I think, well understood now. The reason is when you raise interest rates, you attract foreign hot money. That money comes in, becomes part of the money supply, and creates positive wealth effects, because the money comes in, everybody's richer. That stimulates the economy. So interest rate increases work in the opposite direction to what you would expect in a larger country like the United States, and even much smaller than that. And that was a fairly big reason. At the end of the day, Iceland got foreign carry traders, or foreign carry trades, to the tune of over 40% of GDP. And there's something I find quite ironic about this, because one of the biggest discussions in Iceland these days is how are we going to settle this issue? And now we might get a currency auction, and we might not get a currency auction. So we still haven't dealt with the last crisis, but now a fairly big problem is repeating, because interest rates are 5.75% in Iceland, inflation is almost zero, and so the money is flowing in. So we haven't resolved the last crisis, but we are creating the seeds for the next crisis. And to my mind, I think there is some lack in the field of monetary economics. There's a lack in monetary economics, a recognition of the fact of how hot money inflows really interact. And Iceland crystallizes this for one very important reason. Iceland is plugged into the middle of Northern Europe. The supply chain of companies here is the same as the supply chain of companies in Sweden, Norway, and everywhere else. It's quite wealthy. It's part of the same financial market. And that makes its effect especially strong. So what are we going to do about it? We could use capital flow management, and to deal with the issue of this. But the problem, if you use capital controls, was highlighted by someone in the conference yesterday who said, quote, capital controls are used by emerging markets economies only, unquote. If Iceland uses capital controls, and the other Northern European countries it belongs to do not use capital controls, it's sending a signal. We are not like Sweden, Denmark, Norway, Finland, or whatever. We are like Venezuela or someone like that. It sends the wrong signal. And to me, that is a fundamental reason why I think capital controls are wrong for a country like Iceland, besides all the avoiding issues. However, that said, I think we have managed to create a fantastic event today. And we could not have done it without the most fantastic work done by the organizers of this conference. Marco Arena from the IMF, Sigríður Benediktsdóttir from the Central Bank of Iceland, and my domestic team at the Systemic Risk Center, and Katja, Neugebauer, And I want to ask you to join me in a show of hands for these people who did a fantastic job. And with that, I want to send you off to the sunset, and hopefully one of the pubs will be open and still serving beer.